closer look at 3D printing technology. Now, it's made headlines this week after that shocking announcement from a Texas-based company called Defense Distributed. It claims that it has successfully fired the world's first gun that was made using a 3D printer. Now, this video posted on the group's website appears to show the weapon being fired, and a Forbes writer witnessed the event. So, what exactly is 3D printing? Well, instead of using ink like regular printers, 3D printers use materials like plastic. They take a digital image that you can create using modeling software on a computer and then print it out by building up layer on layer of material to create complex solid objects. Car parts, prosthetic limbs, even human tissue have been 3D printed by manufacturers and doctors who've been using this technique for decades. And thanks to cheaper 3D printer models, the technology is now available to anyone with around $1,000 to spare. And for more, let's bring in our regular contributor, a senior editor at thenewyorker.com, Nicholas Thompson, who joins us live from New York. And Nick, let's back up a bit. For years now, product designers have been using 3D printers for prototyping, right?
Absolutely. I mean, people who design houses, for example, have been using 3D printers for years. People who design airplanes, people who design any sort of complex system, the precision that 3D printing allows and the ability to have flexible designs to change and to say, wait, what if I make this part slightly differently? What will it look like? They've been the early adopters of 3D printing. They've pushed this technology forward and they've helped push it from something on the, you know, something minor, something on the fringes to something that's now becoming ever more mainstream.
Yeah, more mainstream, 3D printing is going retail in a big way. How have consumers taken to the technology to print our own products?
Well, consumers are still just getting into it. I mean, people are printing their own toys. They're buying things that have been built with 3D printers. There aren't that many people who have their own 3D printers at home who are making things. There is been a little bit of a boomlet in 3D jewelry, which is a great application for it, where you can take a complex, intricate design, make it on a 3D printer. And there are people who will design something, ship it out, ship it to a company, will print it for them and ship it back. So it is growing, but it's a relatively small fringe thing. But I think absolutely we're going to see much, much, much more of this very soon.
And the big picture, you know, back in 1993, we didn't even know, most of us didn't know what the web was for. But now we do know in a big way, and we know the power of the web. So looking at the 3D printer today, just how powerful will it be in the future?
I think it's going to be, well, look, nobody knows for sure. Let's throw in a bunch of caveats here. But I think it's going to have a profound effect. It's going to do a couple of things. One, it's going to change a lot of manufacturing. There are certain things for mass production, for example, where 3D printing doesn't work. 3D printing doesn't really give you great economies of scale. You have to do the same thing each time. Injection molds give you great economies of scale. So there are lots of things where huge companies will still make them in huge factories using the traditional methods. However, for small, intricate things, it's going to become vastly, vastly more efficient. And it's going to shake up industries, sometimes for the good and sometimes for the bad. So let's talk about jewelry for a second. It's great, right? Because you can design your own things. Somebody in their own house can make their own jewelry. Suddenly you have all these startups. But there's also this problem where you see an earring you really like, and you can rip it off. So it suddenly makes IP much harder to protect. So it allows lots of startups to come along, and then it creates this massive threat to people whose intellectual property can be copied. So it's both very exciting and, like the early internet, which, you know, decimated the music industry, we don't know who it's going to change for the better and who it's going to change for the ill.
So there's legal concerns with possible IP theft, but there's also something else. And going back to that printed gun, that 3D printed gun, it's leading to a lot of worries in Congress. So should 3D printing be regulated?
That's an extremely hard question, right? So we do have a 3D printed gun, and there's a whole community of people who believe that in the era of Bitcoin and 3D printers, you know, we'll be able to self-sufficient anarchists. And you don't really want to encourage or enable that crowd. But what happens when you start to regulate it? Well, you get a whole bunch of problems. It's very hard for Congress to regulate an emerging, fast-changing technology. It's also something there, it's very important to the United States to be strong in 3D printing, right? China is becoming very, you know, growing very quickly in 3D printing. There's a story in The Economist about 3D printed airplane parts in China right now. Barack Obama in the State of the Union mentioned 3D printing as something where he sees real hope for America. So you don't want to cut it off with intrusive regulation, but you do want to make sure that you protect intellectual property and you prevent the creation of terrible things like homemade weapons that can't be regulated. So very tough choices for Congress right now.
And looking forward, I mean, right now, the technology can print toys, human tissue, that gun that can fire bullets. But how far can the technology go? What will a 3D printer be able to print for us 10 years from now?
Well, it might be able to print your house. I mean, there will be lots of you know, it will probably, right now the limitations on 3D printing is the kind of materials they can use. They can use certain kinds of plastics and certain kinds of metals. They can't use other kinds of plastics, other kinds of metals. They can't use other kinds of materials. They have problems with certain colors. There's, you know, there are technical limitations right now. Those will probably be surpassed. And then it's just an economic question of where does it make more sense to use a 3D printer? Where does it make more sense to use traditional production processes? I think there are lots and lots of things. You know, we're certainly going to see gadgets that are 3D printed. We're certainly going to see any kind of small, intricate device. I think those will be the first things that, you know, your watch, that may well be 3D printed a few years from now or 10 years from now. We'll see.
Yeah, and which companies are leading the pack? Which companies are building the 3D printing future?
There are tons and tons of startups. The one that people talk about the most is, or the one that I've seen the most about and that I, you know, first learned about, you know, I don't know, 8 years ago, is called MakerBot. It's based in Brooklyn. They do all sorts of wonderful 3D printing. It's a company called Shapeways, which is growing very, very quickly. You send them their design, they'll print you something. And then there are about, you know, 10, 20, 30, 100 startups that people are starting to put a lot of money in. We have our first massive IP fight between two 3D printing companies, showing a certain maturity in the industry now that they're suing each other. So it's growing quickly. Venture capitalists are excited, and there's a bright future for some of these companies. You know, many of them will go bankrupt. They'll build out too fast. It is obviously a capital-intensive business. You have to get your plants and build your machines, but it's also one that's growing quickly and one where a lot of smart people are putting a lot of money.
And I got to say, I can't wait to print my first pair of earrings. Nick Thompson, NewYorker.com. Thank you so much for joining us. Fascinating discussion there, as always.